All right, so I'm going to run through some of the things I've been doing on the Ultratrack recently. I just did a remix the other day. I started one, and I've sort of been working on it today as well, of a piece of a Frank Zappa track, which is not the sort of thing I would normally sample, but has a good little bit, which I will demonstrate pretty much right now. So I'm just going to go through some of these tracks, and then once I've gone through what I've done, I'll probably do another video where I make a beat on the machine drum along to this. But to start with, this is the sample that I took from the Frank Zappa album, Shake Your Booty, or Sheek Your Booty. So like, that's got lots of effects on it. If I go out here and I change the send on that, I might just copy. Right, that's cool. Turn that off. Turn that off. And then it sounds like this.
Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your poop shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right up your poop shoe. Don't fool yourself.
So it's, you know, charming work from Mr. Zappa. I called it poop because, I mean, you can hear obvious reasons. Anyway, it's a good track, it's a good album. I just wanted to use that bit because I thought it was kind of funny. So I'm just going to go back. I'm going to put this back up to 100, where it was at. And on this one, I'm just going to paste that back in. That's one cool thing on the Ultratrack is you can just hold just about any button, like so effect 1, effect 2, LFO, whatever, and you can just do copy. And so that's handy between tracks, or just if you want to experiment with something and then go back to it. Just a little tip for you. So then on this track, well actually, the way that sounds with all my effects and everything is this, like this, because I've pitched it down a bit. I'll just get rid of this. I've pitched it down a bit and I've changed the rate, and rate is set to time stretch, and it goes like this. So I got a bunch of flanging going on there, and the flanging is actually it's parameter locked on some of these things. They're trigless locks, so they don't actually have a trig associated with them, so the full sample plays, and then when it gets to this one it just changes some of the settings. So if I hold that down, you've got changes the delay setting on the flanger, which actually that changes the note, so there is some melodic content in there to shape the sample into something which goes along with the other melodic elements in the track a little bit better, which you'll see in a second. I've also got some delay on it. So that's all that's really going on there. The next track I made was this one. And together. So I think that's pretty cool. I also added a drum beat, or a kick really, and it's just this. So this sound started, hang on, I'm just going to copy this whole track, and then I'm going to turn the mix right down on the compressor, and the mix right down on that, and then I'm going to go here. This is what it sounds like initially. So it's, you know, it's a pretty fat kick. I turned the volume up to 18, and then I added some compression, which I'm just going to copy back in now. And just a little bit of gain, obviously some ratio, and I added a dark reverb as well. So yeah, and all that. frustrated another part that I added. So on this one, I just copied this whole track up to here, but then I changed the sample that it's using. So on this one, the sample is like this. And on this one, the sample is like this. But it's the same notes and everything, so it sounds like this. Bit of filtering on it. And a little bit of dark reverb. Which, I feel like the Octatrack gets a bit of flack for, not having good reverbs. Like, I've definitely read on forums, who the fuck should listen to forums, but like, people saying, oh, I don't like the reverbs, they're not very good. And it's like, just, man, like, learn how to use them, like, basically. The dark reverb, I think, is probably the best one for my tastes, but the plate reverb is still pretty good. I think there's a spring reverb? Yeah, there's a spring reverb. I hardly ever use the spring reverb, but the thing about this machine is that each of these effects, like, you read the name of them, like spring reverb or plate reverb or delay or lo-fi, and you sort of like, you get an idea about what they're trying to do, but the extremities of those effects are where some really interesting sounds lie. Like the comb filter is one of the most interesting aspects of this machine because it allows you to add harmonic like overtones to samples to give them melodic content, which they don't otherwise have. So it means you can like make something work with melodically with the rest of your track in a very sort of simple way if it doesn't already. So basically, yeah, dark reverb on that one. By the way, I've got the mix set to send. By default, it's set to mix, and when you do that, when you bring in the mix here, it actually lowers the volume of the bass track because it's mixing in the other bit. But with send, it just sends it like, so this stays the same volume and it just sends a mix of it to the dark reverb. And I find that it just sounds way better. Like, I can actually demonstrate right now. It's like overloading the signal, like, it's hard to explain what it's doing all the time because it's sort of a bit unpredictable, but like sometimes it'll be quieter, other times it will overload like that. It's just depending on what else is happening in your signal chain, but I way prefer the send over the mix. Just a tip if you need a tip. And I also just added this sound here just real quick. So I played this in using the chromatic scale, which puts a keyboard across the trigs, and it plays the sample across the pitches. So when I played it in, it just automatically adjusted the pitches to where they should be, rather than me having to input the trigs and then alter the pitch. It's just a different way of doing it, and sometimes it's better that way. So, got a sort of arpeggio kind of thing going. Well, not an arpeggio, but a sequence. The way I'm going to do this is I'm going to start with these three elements and I'm going to bring in some of the scenes, and on the scenes, on this scene on track one, I've got the rate, so it reverses it and it slows down the time the rate significantly, so it just becomes like a drone and it sounds like this. notice how the flanger is still being affected by these trigless locks to give it the same or similar melodic content that it had before, even though the sample is slowed down and reversed and like crushed to within its life. So I think that's a really cool thing. It's a good tip as well. If I can give you a tip, that's a pretty good tip. I use that quite a bit. So these three elements will sound like this. That's sort of the direction I'm going to take it. And now I'm going to... That's sort of the basis of what I got. Now I'm going to move over to the machine drum and we'll make a beat. Cool? Hey, so in this video I just made, I forgot to record the octatrack in the second part, so you'll probably hear it in the background as I talk about it. But it's mainly going to be the machine drum that you're hearing. So, I don't know. There's not much I can do about it now. I fucked up. So anyway, just be aware of that going into it. I'll try and make it work. Okay. Okay, so we started out on the octatrack, demonstrating a track I made recently, or the beginnings of a track. And now we're over here at the machine drum so that we can add a beat to it. So on this side I've got the Analog 4, and on this side I've got the mono machine. They're not actually doing anything, but because of the way the MIDI clock is all set up, I'm going to be pushing play on the mono machine to make everything play, and then it will go through the Analog 4 to get to the octatrack. But they're both muted and nothing's playing on them anyway, and so at the moment, with just the octatrack playing, got this going. So, yeah, we've already heard that. We don't have to go over it again. And I'm going to mute it for the moment so we can begin a track on here. Now, I already did begin making a beat, but my video broke, so I have to start again. But I didn't get very far anyway. So at the moment, this is what I've got. So, given that I've already sort of talked through this, I'll just quickly go over what I've done. So on this first track, I've got an FM synth, FM drum synth, with a clap sound. And the clap sound sounds like this. It's got an LFO on it though, with the filter. Which is just always running. So, that's on, I've done some pitch changes. I've done some changes on this page. Maybe I can demonstrate later on another track what all of that sounds like. I really wish my video hadn't broken. What are you going to do? Anyway, so I've got a few trigs, and on each of the trigs I've done some, on most of them I've done some different stuff. So sounds like this. And I also put an LFO controlling the filter, which, so it just keeps fading in and out like that. So before going too much further, I'll just quickly explain the structure of the machine drum. There's 16 tracks, which is pretty, like, insane. It's just so many tracks. I never use 16. They're all exactly the same. You can put any single machine you want on them. It's extremely flexible. Very powerful. I can't believe there are 16 tracks, to be honest. Like, for reference, the Mono Machine has 6 tracks. The Analog 4 obviously has 4 tracks. The Octatrack has 8 tracks. 16 tracks. I guess it's a drum machine, so yeah, whatever, but that's still staggering to me. And the interesting thing about the LFOs is that each track has its own LFO, but each track's LFO doesn't have to operate on that track. If I go to the LFO page, you can select which track each LFO affects, which is really handy, because you could have one track with 16 LFOs on that one track. I've never done that before. That actually sounds like a cool experiment. But yeah, it's huge. Any combination of that, really, like, I can use 2 LFOs from these ones, 5 LFOs for this one, you know, whatever you want. That's pretty cool. But each track, like I said, they're all the same. They've got a synthesis page. They've got an effects page, which is a little bit misleading because there's no reverb or delay or anything on this page. What you've got is filter, high pass, low pass, resonance, sample rate reduction, which is really nice. I use that constantly. Just sounds really crunchy. I mean, I can just show you right now. Very cool. And then then you've got a EQ and amplitude modulation, depth and frequency. Interesting results can happen with these two. And then in routing, this is where you've got your reverb, your delay, your pan, your volume, your distortion. Distortion, not great. I don't actually use it that much. Quite a digital distortion, which is a bit of a shame because some of the synthesis pages on some of the sounds have distortion on them, and it's a really nice distortion. I kind of wish that they had moved that distortion over, but I guess it's the way it's modeled. Like some of the synths, like the 808 and the 909, the classic drum machines, they can be sent through distortion and stuff, and they've modeled it to be for those synths. So that's fair enough, really. Anyway, synthesis, effects, routing, every track is the same. So on this second track, I've got this cowbell, which I haven't done much to, but what I have done, if I go over to the Octatrack and I unmute this channel, I've sort of pitched it to the track, so it sounds like this. So, other than that, I have fucked around with some of these things, tone and decay, and I think that's about it. But other than that, I haven't really done a whole lot. Like I said, really like the sample rate reduction, but I'm not going to use it on this sound. So I'm not really going to do much with that cowbell. It's got some reverb on it. That's pretty much all I want. I could do something with these. I don't know. I might just turn that off. So anyway, without further ado, let's go into a new track. So I'll just show you how this all works, the process of selecting sounds. So I hit the kit button, go to edit. We're selected on track 3 now. We've got multiple synth engines. The GND, I don't remember what it stands for, but it's basically a... it's just got a sine wave, a noise, and I don't know what that one stands for, but it sounds like that. Then you've got like a 808 909 emulation. So you got 808 kick, snare, clap. Oh, I guess that's a clap. And then you got bass drum 2, which is like 909 kick. So you basically, it's the same drum machine. It's just that they provided you with an 808 kick and a 909 kick for different, you know, purposes. I think that's fine. It works well enough, and it's pretty good emulation, I think. Like, it doesn't sound exactly the same, but it's got its own character. It's quite digital, but it still sounds organic. So I often skip that one, though, because I think that some of these other machines are super interesting. Like, we've got the FM machines, which we've already sort of gone over, but... like, the kick drum sounds quite different. Maybe I'll just select it quickly and show. Oh, that's the wrong page. So, very FM, and you can really just take it to wild places. But... we're going to do something different. So what else we got here? So these are all like, they're all different sounds. They all have different options in the synthesis page. But they're all kind of like presets. So when you select one, it just gives you the basic sound with sort of default settings, and you can just... you can take it where you want, into crazy places. So this machine is the E12 machine, which is like a 12-bit sampler. Or not sampler, but 12-bit samples playback drum machine. And then we've got the PI, which is, I don't know why it's called the PI, but it's physical modeling. And this is one of my favorites, I gotta say. Especially the bass drum. Like, why don't we just put some in here? Some trigs. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna bring in the kick drum on the Octatrack so we don't, like, interfere with each other. So... I think that sounds really awesome. I'm actually just going to save that real quick. I'm just going to call it poop. Poop zapper. How about that? Well, poop zap. Because I'm, you know, extremely mature. So, I like that. But I'm going to add some other things to this, and I'm going to mute those first few tracks. So one of the tricks that I like to do on this machine, I don't know how much of a trick it is, but I don't know, whatever, is to take one of the E12 samples, maybe that one, or that one, yeah, that one, and make it quite short. Well, the thing is, I wanted to make it have a short decay so it would be really snappy, but I can't actually do that for what I want to do. So, because I need to have a long decay, and I'll tell you why. Because what I want to do is settings for the samples down here, retrig and retrig timing. But if I turn down the decay, you know, it affects the tail of the retrigs as well. So I'm going to make the decay maximum. What I'm going to do is I'm going to set a trig right at the start here, and I'm going to set another one down here. And this one, I'm going to set the timing to really fast, like 1, 2, and this one to really long. And hopefully, oh, what I need to do is also hit this slide. So then, I'm just on track 4, it will go, it will slide between those two values across those two trigs. Now, each of the machines that are on this table, the Mono Machine, the Analog 4, and the Octatrack, they all have this slide functionality. So it means you can slide smoothly between steps, or between trigs, or have no slide, so it just steps between them and get like a sample and hold kind of sounds, especially if you're dealing with like filters or whatever. So what it sounds like, hopefully, if I've done it all correctly, is this. Well, it needs some work. So what we're going to do. So what I'm going to do is actually make this 64 steps. I'm going to clear that. No. Just get rid of it. Get rid of that. Maybe I'll just make it 32 steps actually. And I'll put the slide across there and there. Now, it's not quite doing what I want it to do. I'm not sure why. I feel like the decay is stopping us a little bit here. So I might just move this forward a bit. Thank you. So, quite happy with all of that. I think it sounds pretty rad. I don't know if I really should keep going, because this video is getting a bit long. But yeah, just to recap, I've only got four tracks going here. One of them's a clap sound. Sounds like this. So, you know, nothing like a clap at all. Then I've got a cowbell, which does still sound like a cowbell. And then this kick drum. And that's the physical modeling kick. And it's, you know, there's parameter locks going, as there are on the other ones. And then I've got this last track. Almost getting into some granular synthesis territory there. And all together. So I think you can probably see how powerful this is. I've used four tracks out of 16. There's a whole 12. I could make an entire set using just one kit and one pattern and just bringing things in and out. Like, it's insane how powerful this is. I tell this to people all the time, how insanely powerful this is. Like, if Electron were ever to make a machine drum too, I don't know how they would top it. I guess they could add new machines and do a whole bunch of stuff, but like, I'm assuming that they're probably not going to do that, because why would they? This thing is basically perfect. the only thing I think that would make it better is if I had an analog heat attached to it, you know, one day when I can afford that. Anyway, there is still some work to be done here. Like, the drum beat doesn't quite match up to the original sample, and if I play and demonstrate, but I think the reason for that is because I've got all of this starting on like the first beat, and one thing you can do on all of these machines is hold down function and you can move the sequence along. So what I might do is just quickly copy pattern, and go to a new pattern and paste pattern. And I might just experiment with moving it forward a bit, to say, go here, to there, on each of them. Shit. Which actually kind of sucks, and I'm going to go back to the other one, because now it's out of sync with the other drum over there, and sometimes this is just what happens. So there are ways I can fix this, or what I might end up doing is just bringing this beat in later in the track once I've taken out that initial sample that starts the track, because I prefer the way it sounds with the other kick drum. If I remove the Frank Zappa sample and I bring in the other elements of the track, it sounds like this. Yeah. this machine. I don't think I'll ever get rid of this bad boy. I'll probably make another video on this guy because there's just so much to do. There's so many things I can do with it. Maybe I'll make one soon where I just do one track, which uses every single LFO on that one track, and just see how crazy that is. But for the moment, that's it. Hope you enjoyed it. See ya.